Positive psychology is an exciting new theoretical model to consider, and it offers excellent ideas and interventions for therapists. My objective today is to provide insight into ways that positive psychology can impact our clinical work on a philosophical and therapeutic level. Positive psychology is the scientific study of what goes right in life, from birth to death, and it all stops in between. It is a newly christened approach within psychology that takes seriously as a subject matter those things that make life most worth living. What is good about life is as genuine as what is bad, and therefore deserves equal attention from therapists. Positive psychology resides somewhere in that part of the human landscape that is metaphorically north of neutral. It is the study of what we are doing when we are not frittering life away. Like solution-focused therapy, it's a constructivist model, so we look at the client's life experiences and narratives as an important part of clinical treatment. Here's the mind map, and as you'll see, there aren't as many components to cover in this week's lesson. We'll continue to use the case of Marcella, so pause the video as needed to refresh your memory. I'll start by saying a few words about Martin Seligman, the founder of positive psychology. He's a former APA president and was well known for his work with psychodynamic therapy models. A big change occurred in his life, and this is highlighted on page 26 of this week's handout on positive psychology. In a brief story called Nikki and the Weeds, or Nikki's Story. As you read, you'll get a sense of what caused Seligman to shift his viewpoint towards the positive nature of psychology. He wanted to find research to back his new ideology, so he basically split the field into two camps: clinicians who are more interested in science and research, and those interested in the practice of psychotherapy. His goal was to bring the two together in his development of positive psychology. In the weekly videos section, I've added an optional video that focuses on PERMA and may provide a deeper understanding of some of the concepts that I'll cover here. In Seligman's video, he talks about important elements of what it takes to flourish and character strengths by profession. Now, before delving into the central constructs of positive psychology, let's first look at its basic philosophy. Human goodness and excellence are as authentic as disease, disorder, and distress, and as such, we must challenge the assumptions of the disease model of pathology, which we find in the DSM-5, and instead focus on strengths as opposed to weaknesses. One can best learn about the good life by engaging in it. So as therapists utilizing this model, we emphasize the good life and positive living with our clients. Ultimately, scientific methods and research would need to reinforce the work we do as we measure the increase in hope and self-efficacy, and I will highlight some of this research shortly. Here are three central constructs of the positive psychology model, and they can be thought of as three pillars of the model. Now, the first one, positive subjective experiences, involves our ability to adapt to and experience positive emotions. In our work as clinicians, we engage in processes and interventions that help our clients experience an increase in joy rather than just a decrease in depression. With this in mind, what might be some experiences in which Marcella could engage to achieve more positive emotions? For starters, we could include her love of horseback riding into her treatment. Now, I'll take this one step further and highlight the concept that Seligman discussed in his video called PERMA, which outlines in further detail the tenets of positive subjective experiences. Please view his video if you want to find out more. Now, the second central construct is positive traits of the individual, such as positive thinking and wellness. And we've covered some of these traits in other models we've studied. Think about some of Marcella's strengths, such as the ability to set an important goal in her life of becoming a pediatrician. How could these goals be used to develop wellness in her life? One way might be for her to find ways to incorporate this goal more readily into her schedule through volunteering, interviewing other pediatricians, etc. Finally, positive enabling institutions are those that facilitate the development and display of our positive traits. What companies promote development among employees? Seeking to work for such companies, even through volunteering or donations, can be an important part of developing a positive view of self. What are the positive institutions that Marcella is associated with? Next, let's look at the goals and interventions of positive psychology. Our goals are to live life with dignity and purpose, and become motivated to explore and live according to our value systems. Think of other models we've studied that focused on the importance of values. We also want to develop an optimistic perspective on our potential, motives, and basically an optimistic viewpoint on the future. We seek to develop in ourselves the quality of eudaimonia, or being true to our inner self, identifying and cultivating our virtues and living in accordance with them. Consider Marcella's virtues, her moral standards. How might we help her in regards to loving her family when she knows they haven't always supported her when she needed it most? Now let's switch to positive psychology interventions now. To learn more about some of the prominent techniques of positive psychology, you'll read about them in this week's handout. Although this week's therapy video is not a counseling session, per se, it should give a new perspective on the strength of showing gratitude towards others. Additional interventions include modeling positive behaviors. Our positive emotions as therapists can be contagious and can serve to help others capitalize on positive events. Also, it's important to actively seek to help others. Many of our clients are isolated, so developing their helping relationships, even reaching out to help others, can be powerful moderators of growth. The process of therapy for this model is somewhat general and depends upon the creativity of the therapist administering it. Guidelines include reversing the focus from negative to positive. This is not simply ignoring bad things, but focusing more fully on the positive, which can be done by taking a mental spotlight each night before bed and reviewing what went well that day. Taking small steps, or baby steps, as Bill Murray once said in the movie What About Bob, and increasing difficulty over time. Next, develop a language of strength and incorporate it into your life. Remember that athletes train daily to develop physical muscles and skills, and they visualize success even before it has happened. Clients can make the same kinds of efforts to boost their mental facility by identifying one top strength and using it at least once every day. And finally, build strategies that foster hope. What coping mechanisms do clients already have that can help them through rough times? Helping them construct an emotional toolbox can promote success in this area. How might this process be beneficial for Marcella as she works on the process of achieving her goals? Next, let's consider some research that may support positive psychology, or at least adapting a more positive framework for living one's life. Did you smile in your college yearbook photo? Pause the video and read about this study. Your marital bliss may be at stake. Next, pause the video and read about this interesting study based on handwritten autobiographies of 180 Catholic nuns. It's amazing to think that positive emotional content in early autobiographies was directly correlated with happiness 60 years later. There are assessment measures that you or your clients can take to assess your self-efficacy. Pause the video to review. Now, as we look, we'll see hope in terms of agency or a sense of personal power, and pathways indicating our resourcefulness in finding solutions to problems. We'll get a chance to look more closely at these studies in class. Finally, let's break open the Word and look at a few Bible verses that may reinforce some of the concepts we've learned about positive psychology. From Philippians chapter 4, verse 12, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. Here are a few other verses, and please pause the video as you consider the significance of these and other verses, both biblical and non-biblical, in the therapeutic environment. I'm not saying that you'll necessarily mention these verses directly in therapy with clients, but bringing a positive spiritual attitude has the potential to make us stronger and more caring clinicians. One more thing. We'll have a discussion in class that will follow these guidelines. Hopefully, it will bring about a practical understanding of some of the aspects of positive psychology. And remember, don't worry.
Be happy.
Be happy.
Be happy now.
And have a great week.
Don't worry. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy.